On this map, we're seeing a couple of recent rail projects scattered across Europe. If instead of longitude and latitude, we'd use some other metric on the x and y axis, we get what you might call a scatter plot, if you're into that sort of thing. Let's plot the number of trains per hour in direction on one axis and the number of passengers per day on the other axis. The Grand Paris Express is by far the project with the highest projected ridership, 2 million passengers a day. For comparison, the existing Paris Metro with its 14 lines has currently about 4 million daily passengers. The most important part of Grand Paris Express is the new Line 15, a circle line around Paris. Then there are three more new lines, 16, 17 and 18, and the extensions of the existing Metro Line 14 to the north and south. That's a total length of about 200 kilometers, most of it underground. By plotting both track and tunnel length, we can see which projects have the most tunnels. A lot of tunneling might lead to higher construction costs. Well, actually maybe sometimes not, because then there are fewer nimble frogs and nimby neighbors inhibiting planning and construction. The most expensive project in our comparison, High Speed 2, doesn't even have that long tunnels. It's a high-speed line from London to Birmingham and Manchester, and it's currently projected to cost an equivalent of more than 50 billion euros. Much more interesting than absolute construction cost is the cost per passenger. So let's divide construction cost by daily passengers on the y-axis. We see that HS2 costs less than 200,000 euros per daily passenger, which means over a time span of 50 years, the construction cost distributes to about 10 euros per passenger. This is still somewhat skewed, since some long-distance projects like HS2, VDE8 from Nuremberg to Berlin, or the LGV from Bordeaux to Toulouse and Spain appear to be much more expensive relatively. But what if additionally on the x-axis we plot costs divided by daily passenger kilometers, that is, divided by how far all passengers on one day travel in total on the respective line? The long-distance projects all remain well below 1,000 euros per daily passenger kilometer, meaning over 50 years it will only be a couple of cents per passenger kilometer. Some short-haul projects like the M3 in Brussels, S-Link in Salzburg, or the U5 in Hamburg, on the other hand, tend to be more expensive per passenger kilometer, but much less expensive per passenger. I guess no project is expensive in both dimensions, since then it wouldn't be economically pertinent. The Brenner Basis Tunnel being somewhat of an exception, since it's not primarily for passengers, but for freight. Construction cost is also a rough indicator for CO2 emissions during construction. Concrete and steel production, together with the energy consumption on the construction site, are usually responsible for a large part of the emissions when building a railway. And daily passenger kilometers can be, with some outliers, an indicator for emission savings when the project is operational, that is, by how much yearly emissions are reduced, primarily due to modal shift from the car to that rail project. In the past video, we've already looked at CO2 emissions of subway projects in Berlin and Hamburg. It turns out that it's really difficult to get a reliable estimate of CO2 emissions and savings. That's why, in addition to the official or best effort reference emissions, we can also plot low and high estimates that are calculated in a generic way based on key metrics of the projects, for better comparability. By dividing the construction emissions by the yearly emission savings, we find out how many years it would take in theory to amortize the construction emissions, that means when the project was actually worth it CO2-wise. As we see on the x-axis, in the worst case, some projects take hundreds of years, so virtually forever, to amortize. The same projects take only a couple of dozen years to amortize under some best-case assumption. The projects in the lower left corner come off quite well in both cases. There's Crossrail, for instance, a high-capacity railway with 10 new stations and 20 kilometers of tunnels in the core of London, extending far into the surrounding region. Then there is the Zweite Stammstrecke München, which similarly cuts through Munich. It has lower passenger numbers, but also a much shorter tunneling section of only 7 kilometers. And as we've learned before, tunnels in particular have a great impact on CO2 emissions during construction. The Linienkreuz U2 U5 in Vienna is another example where they boast about emission savings of the project when operational, but don't tell us anything about the construction emissions. But yeah, you might ask, does it even make sense to look at amortization on a project level? Considering the entirety of the public transport network, infrastructure-related emissions are still only a fraction of total public transport emissions. And as long as certain transport ministers in their car frenzy prefer to build new highways instead of new railways, there is no indication that this will change anytime soon. There are also projects like Stuttgart 21. According to the official estimates, it would reduce CO2 emissions by about 70,000 tons a year, which is quite a lot for such a project. Then it amortizes in a few decades. But if to the delight of the opponents of Stuttgart 21 it ends up actually performing worse than the current main station of Stuttgart that is to be replaced, it would not save any emissions and it would obviously never amortize its construction emissions. To wrap up, let's have a look at speed. There are two metrics to look at here, the maximum speed that trains on the respective line will reach and the average traveling speed including stops at stations, which we call the commercial speed. Of course, the maximum speed will always be higher than the commercial speed. We could also divide commercial speed by maximum speed to better see how the ratio between them differs from one project to another. Then the x-axis is free to plot the average station spacing, which we get by dividing the track length by the number of stations. Of course, station spacing varies greatly, from metro projects with a 1 km spacing like in Toulouse and Hamburg, to Crosswell and Grand Paris Express with about 3 km. And for long distance projects, stations are obviously much farther apart from each other. Their commercial speed ratio might not even be that much higher though, because there are annoying things other than stations that might make trains go slower than maximum speed. Finally, bear in mind that the selection of projects is arbitrary and the data is not necessarily reliable. If you want to have a closer look or improve it or add more projects also from other parts of Europe, the link to the interactive version of this video is on screen and in the description.